Philippine Senator Rafi Tulfo wants the Kuwaiti government to issue a public apology to the Philippines following Ranara's rape slay. Tulfo also recommended to implement a pre-screening evaluation on potential employers, including a psychiatric examination before OFWs are sent abroad. Tulfo says nearly 200 Filipino workers have been killed in Kuwait since 2016, with 80% of those deaths due to physical abuse. The family of a Filipino tourist detained in Myanmar appeals for help from the Philippine government. Kayla Samson and her friends were arrested on January 17 after taking a boat ride in a city in Thailand near Myanmar's border. Her family says the basis for their arrest remains unclear. Samson's family has already reached out to the Philippine embassy in Yangon, but they were told diplomats are barred from entering the area due to the insurgency there.
Nawagan po ako sa ating gobyerno, kay President Marcos at sa mga kinaukulan na sana po bigyan po nila ng pansin yung pagka-detain po ng anak ko kasi hindi ko na po kaya mag-antay ng ilang araw pa po. Sobra na po sa 10 araw. Mahirap na po para sa akin.
Sana po matulungan po kami mapawi si ate kasi ilang days na po siya doon, ilang days na rin po kaming walang tulog, walang kain po, kakaisip sa kanya kung paano. Kasi po last time na sinabi niya sa amin, may isa daw po doon na medyo bastos po na pulis, akala daw po nagtrabaho siya sa KTV, kaya ngayon po mas grabe po yung kaba namin.
Scores of fatalities are reported in Pakistan from a bus crash over the weekend. At least 41 individuals were killed Sunday after a bus plunged off a bridge and fell into a ravine in the southwestern province of Balochistan. Two survivors are in critical condition. The government assures the public the cause of the accident will be investigated. South Korea eases its indoor mask mandate as its COVID cases continue to fall. Most indoor locations, such as schools and gyms, will no longer require face masks. But authorities say mask wearing remains in effect in public transport and in health facilities. Officials vow to closely monitor the number of new COVID cases after the easing of the mandate. Over in the U.S., protesters took to the streets once more to decry police brutality in the wake of the death of Tyre Nichols. Demonstrations were held from New York to San Francisco amid growing calls for an end to abuses of authority. Nichols was pulled over for alleged reckless driving on January 7th. Videos showed Memphis police officers aggressively pulling him out of his car, pushing him to the ground and beating him when he tried to run away. He was hospitalized and died 3 days later. Five officers have been fired and charged with second-degree murder. New Russian strikes in Ukraine leave at least 3 civilians dead. Moscow's attack on Sunday targeted a hospital and a school in the southern city of Kherson. Officials say 9 others were injured. Kherson was occupied by Russian troops in the early days of the war until Kyiv's forces recaptured it in November last year. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky has since renewed his call to the West to expedite the sending of weapons to his country. His appeal came as he said Ukraine's troops were facing a difficult situation against Russian forces in the Donetsk region. We begin in the Middle East, where U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken embarks on a visit amid escalating tensions between Israel and Palestine. Blinken arrived in Egypt on Sunday to kick off his 3-day tour of the region. He travels to Jerusalem on Monday, where he will meet with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and Palestine's leader Mahmoud Abbas. The visit of Washington's top diplomat had long been planned, but it took on a new urgency after 10 Palestinians were killed by Israeli forces during last week's raid at the West Bank. The incident was followed by a shooting at a synagogue in Jerusalem over the weekend, leaving 7 Israelis dead. Blinken told local media in Cairo he will urge Israel and Palestine's leaders to take steps to de-escalate the tension.